Now we are taking the chapter 6, the application of derivatives. So far we have discussed about the derivative of composite functions, the inverse trigonometric functions, the implicit functions, the exponential functions, and the logarithmic functions. Here we will study application of derivative to other disciplines like engineering, science, social science, and various other fields. We'll try to learn the rate of change of quantities, find the equation of tangents and normals, the turning points on a graph, and the largest and smallest value locally, and also locally also, and then we'll do it globally also, where it is increasing, decreasing, and then we'll see about the how to find the approximate value of certain quantities. Rate of change of quantities. Just recall that derivative ds by dt was what? It is the rate of change of the distance with respect to time. Rate of change of distance with respect to time. So in this way, when one quantity, say y, varies with certain quantity x, x means y is varying with respect to x, we say y equal to fx, then dy by dx, dy by dx is nothing but, which is f dash x, is the rate of change of y with respect to x. Rate of change of y with respect to x. So at certain point x equal to x0, you can find out the rate of change also. If two variables x and y, they are not varying with respect to one another but with respect to some other variable t, that is x equal to ft and y equal to gt. This x is related to t, y is related to t. So the chain rule will be dy by dx, this will be dy by dx will be dy by dt divided by dx by dt, dy by dt divided by dx by dt. And you see this dt dt cancels out, it is actually equal to dy by dx only. So the rate of change of y with respect to x, this can be calculated using the rate of change of y and that of x both respect to the third one, which is t. Let us take some example. Find the rate of change of area of circle per second with respect to its radius, where r is given like this. We know that the area of circle is what? A is equal to pi r square. So dA by dr, this is the rate of change of area with respect to r. So dA by dr will be pi will come out and 2r, r square will be 2r, so 2 pi r. So at r equal to 5, we just place r equal to 5 here, dA by dt dr will become 10 pi. So this is the area of the circle, which is changing at the rate of what? 10 pi, this 10 pi centimeter square. The volume of cube is increasing at a rate of this per second. How fast is the surface area increasing when the length of an edge is 10 centimeter? So here x is the length of the side, and we know that the v, if v is the volume and s is the surface area of the cube, volume is x cube, that is the length cube, and surface area is nothing but 6x square, 6 side square. So dv by dt is what? It is given as 9 cubic centimeters per second. So dv by dt can be easily written like this, equated to 9. Now this 9 is dv by dt, that is d of dt of volume. Volume is what? X cube. So d by dt of x cube is 3, this will apply the chain rule. So 3x square, then again dx by dt, this one. Now this one more thing is given. See, dx by dt we just found out at 3 by x square, but ds by dt, what is the surface area s? Ds by dt is what? It is equal to d by dt of 6x square, that is equal to d by dx of 6x square, 6 will come out, and then again dx by dt, but we have just found out dx by dt as 3 by x square. Now we can place it here. So 12x into this d by dx of this is 12x, then 3 into 3 by x square, that will be 36 by x. So when we put x equal to 10 in this question, it will be ds by dt, that is 3.6 centimeter square per second. A stone is dropped into a quiet lake and waves move in a circle at a speed of 4 centimeter per second. So at that instant, when the radius of a circle wave is 10 centimeter, how fast is the enclosed area increasing? So the A is the area of a circle, which is we have known as A equal to pi r square. The rate of change of area with respect to time is nothing but dA by dt. So dA by dt will be what? if you divide pi r square or differentiate pi r square with respect to t, it will be d by dr of pi r square, then again dr by dt. This will be 2 pi r dr by dt by chain rule. Dr by dt is already given, it is 4 centimeter per second. So you can just place it here in this equation. So if you place r equal to 10, dA by dt will be 2 pi into 10 into 4, that is 80 pi. That is the area, which is enclosed area, is increasing at the rate of 80 pi. 180 pi means 2 into 2 pi into 10 into 4, that we have applied r equal to 10. So when r equal to 10, this is the value. So dy with x, or the derivative, is positive if y increases as x increases, and this is negative if y decreases as x, your x increases. Now we have one more example. The length x of a rectangle is decreasing at the rate of this, and width is increasing at the rate of this. So length is increasing, width is decreasing, or one is increasing, one is decreasing. You can understand like this. Here one we have to take as negative, other we have to take as positive. When x equal to 10 cm and y equal to 6 cm, we have to find the rate of change of the perimeter and the area of rectangle. So the length x, this is decreasing, and width y is increasing. Now these are doing, or they are increasing, decreasing with respect to what? With respect to time. So dx by dt is given as, because it is decreasing, we have taken as minus 3 cm per minute, and dy by dt is 2 cm per minute. What is the parameter? Parameter of a rectangle, if this is the length, bed, so 2l plus b, 2 into l plus b. So just differentiate both sides, dp by dt will be equal to 2, dx by dt plus dy by dt, and just place the values here. Dx by dt we know minus 3, dy by dt is also given as 2. How about the area? Area is equal to x into y. So dA by dt will be the, we'll apply the Leibniz rule. And then we will place the values as per given in the question. And this will be 2 cm square per minute. We have used x equal to 10 and y equal to 6. The total cost in rupees associated with the production of x units of an item is given by this. You have to find the marginal cost when 3 units are produced, where by marginal cost we mean the instantaneous rate of change of total cost at any level of output. So it is given that the marginal cost, which is the rate of change of total cost with respect to the output. So that is, if this is cost C, so we say dc by dx. So we'll take the differential of this, means this one, and then we'll take the differential of this. So at x equal to 3, what is happening? If you take the differential, if you place this, you get the value as this one. We are just placing x equal to 3 in the differential. It will be this value. That is, you can just take it as 30.02. The required marginal cost will be 30.02. The total revenue in rupees received from the sale of x units of product is given by this. You have to find the marginal revenue when x equal to 5. Whereby the marginal revenue, we mean the rate of change of total revenue with respect to the number of items sold at an instant. Here we have done already a question like this. So the marginal revenue is the rate of change of total revenue with respect to the number of units sold. So this is nothing but, if you say r as this rx is there, so we take dr by dx. So this is the differential. Now place x equal to 5 here, because x equal to 5 need to be found out. This will be 66. Increasing and decreasing function. We'll talk about the increasing and decreasing function, how we can confirm it, or how can we know with use of differentiation. How can we apply differentiation to know this? Just consider this function fx equal to x square. The graph is shown like this. See, at this point, just this point, and at just this point, if you calculate, you can calculate the, say, the slope also. There are various things you can calculate. So if you see, if you place x equal to minus values here value, it approaches zero. And when you place plus value here and like this, it approaches zero. So fx equal to x square, here you see it is decreasing, the slope. And here it is increasing. So as we move from one point to another, the height of the graph is decreasing, while here the height of the graph is increasing. We see that the function is said to be increasing for the real number if this x is greater than 0. Or when we say the function is said to be decreasing for real numbers x is less than 0. Now let us see more formal definition. Let I be an interval. So this is an interval, some interval. It will be an open interval which is contained in the domain of real valued function f. And f is said to be, now this function which we are talking about is this interval. It is increasing if x1 is less than x2, but the function at this value x1 and the function at this value x2, that is y1, y2, you can say. So y1 is less than y2, that is fx1 is less than equal to y2 or fx2. And strictly increasing when this is equal to sign is not there. Means if x1 is less than x2, then fx1 is less than fx2. When we talk about decreasing, if x1 is less than x2, this sign changes, that is fx1 becomes greater than or equal to fx2. In this similar, x1, x2 belong to this, x1, x2 belong to this region only. It is strictly decreasing if x1 is less than x2 and this is equal to sign is not there. That means fx1 becomes greater than fx2. So see, this is increasing function, but this is strictly increasing function. This is a decreasing function and this is strictly decreasing function. And this function is neither decreasing nor increasing. See, neither. Sometimes it increases, sometimes it decreases, sometimes it increases and sometimes it stands still also. So neither increasing nor decreasing. We have another definition. Let x0 be a point in that domain, which is the real valued function here. Then f is said to be increasing, strictly increasing, decreasing, or strictly decreasing at this point x0. All these at point x0 in that interval. If there exists an open interval I containing this x0, such that the f is increasing, strictly increasing, decreasing, or strictly decreasing respectively in I. Okay, let us clarify what we have just seen. In case of increasing function, let me show you with a graph so that you understand it better, okay? Or an example. Okay, just take an example. First, let me give you a hint. See, if I have a graph here, I have this x0 point. This x0 point in this interval, that is the I interval. Here, you take a point just before that, that is some infinitesimal small, very small h tends to 0. So this becomes x0 minus h and this part becomes x0 plus h. H is very small. H is just this distance. If you come here, you say that x1 is less than x2, then fx1 is less than or equal to fx2. Then we say it is increasing. It is increasing because it is actually increasing. But in this is the geometrical interpretation. I'll show you this geometrical interpretation also. First, let us see the question. Fx equal to 7x minus 3 is a function. We have to show that it is strictly increasing in R. So x1 is less than x2. If x1 and x2, there are two numbers in R, this real number. So if x1 is less than x2, multiply 7 both sides and subtract 3 both sides. Nothing will change. So fx1 also is less than fx2. So now it is strictly increasing as per the definition on R. Right? Let us have one more theorem. F is continuous on AB. AB means this square bracket means AB is included. Round bracket means AB is not included. Okay? So this F is continuous on this AB and differentiable on the open interval AB. This is open interval, this is closed interval. So F is increasing in this interval if f dash x is greater than 0. If it is increasing, the derivative of function at x, this x belongs to this a and b, f dash x is greater than 0. If f is decreasing in ab, then f dash x has to be less than 0. The differential should be less than 0 for each x which is in between ab. F is a constant function in ab, that means f dash x is not greater than 0 or not less than 0, but it is actually equal to 0 for any point which is between a, b. So let us prove it. Assume x1 and x2 which belongs to a, b, this region, such that x1 is less than x2. But we know by mean value theorem, we have already seen this, that there exists a point c between x and x2 such that this should hold. This is from mean value theorem. That is, f dash c will be equal to fx2 minus fx1 by x2 minus x1. This one. So f dash c can be written as this f dash c, this we have taken the denominator, we have taken here. This one. So fx2 minus fx1 is equal to f dash x, x2 minus x1. And this fx2 minus fx1, we know that f dash c is greater than 0, this is greater than 0, right? First one, f dash c is greater than 0, so this one is greater than 0. That means if you take this on the right hand side, fx2 becomes greater than fx1. That is why it is increasing. So x1 less than x2, but fx1 is less than fx2. That is, f is increasing in this a to b. So the rest part is also there. You know, you can just do it the way you can apply that theorem again. So f is strictly increasing in a, b if f dash x is greater than 0. F is strictly decreasing in a, b if f dash x is less than 0. And f, the function will be increasing or decreasing in R if it is so in every interval of R. Now we have to show that the function f is given by fx equal to this is strictly increasing on R. So this is the function. Just take the derivative, that is d by dx of this function. So what it will be? 3x square minus 6x plus 4. This is d by dx. So make it as perfect square. So you get here perfect square, that cannot be negative. This is positive, this is positive. So all this, if you see properly, that it is greater than 0 in every interval of R. So the function f is strictly increasing on R. We have to prove that the function fx equal to cos x is strictly decreasing in this, strictly increasing in this, neither increasing nor decreasing in this. See, this is about cos x. So we have to talk about 0 to pi and pi to 2 pi. So this is whole, we are talking about whole 360 degree. 0 to pi is 180 degree. So 0 to 180 degree, 180 to 360 degree. And we have to say that it is neither increasing nor decreasing in the 0 to 360 degree. So just see that fx is what? Cos x. What is f dash x? This will be minus sin x. F dash x is minus sin x. And since for each x which belongs to 0 to pi, sin x will always be greater than 0 from 0 to pi. Means first quadrant, sin x will always be greater than 0. When it is greater than 0, this will be negative always. That is, f dash x will be less than 0. This is plus, but we have our negative sign. So it will be less than 0. So f is strictly decreasing in 0 to pi. Same discussion goes for pi to 2 pi. See, in pi to 2 pi, sin x will always be less than 0. When it is less than 0, it will be minus, and we have minus sign also. So minus minus will become plus, so f dash x will be greater than 0. So f is strictly increasing in pi and 2 pi in between this interval. And in 0 to pi it is increasing, decreasing, and pi to 2 pi it is increasing. So we can say that this function is neither increasing nor decreasing in 0 to 2 pi, because in between two things are happening together. Find the intervals in which the function f, which is given by this, is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. So fx is this, take f dash x, that is the derivative. And just put it this equal to 0, f dash x equal to 0. We get x equal to 2. So this is the point 2. Now this 2 divides real line into two disjoint interval. That is, this is a real line. This is 2. So we have minus infinity to 2 and 2 to infinity. These are the two intervals, minus infinity to 2 and 2 to infinity. So in this interval, in the interval minus infinity to 2, if you place any value from minus infinity to 2, you will always get value which is less than 0. So this f dash x will be always less than 0. So f is strictly increasing in this interval. But if you take the second interval, that is 2 infinite, in this two infinite, f dash x will always be greater than 0. If you place value, any value, you can place 2 also. Just check it, check with 2. You will see that this will be always greater than 0. So f is strictly increasing in this. So these are two partitions, and this is strictly increasing in the second part. Find the intervals in which the function f given by this is strictly increasing and strictly decreasing. So we'll take the derivative, put it to 0, and we'll see the point, the critical points. And then we'll find out where it is increasing, where it is decreasing, strictly increasing, strictly decreasing. Fx is this, f dash x is what? Derivative of this. You can take the, make the factors, this will be the value, and just place it 0. So x will be 3, and x will be minus 2. So these are the two points. These are the two critical points, f dash equal to 0, you put x equal to minus 2 and 3. So the point is x equal to minus 2 and x equal to 3. This divides the real line into three disjoint intervals. What are these intervals? Minus infinity to minus 2, then minus 2 to 3, and then 3 to infinity. These are three disjoint intervals, as you see here. These are three different intervals. So what we'll do here is, we'll try to find out for these three intervals. And if you place the value, you have to place the values. Okay, you see that in this interval, these two intervals, f dash x is positive, while in this interval, minus 2 to 3, f dash x is negative. So the function f is strictly increasing in the interval this, while the function is strictly decreasing in this function, in this range, minus 2 to 3. And f is neither increasing nor decreasing in R. So these are the ranges, minus infinity to 2, because minus minus you get, f is strictly increasing. Minus 2 to 3, it is strictly decreasing, because you have minus into plus, that is, you get minus. Here plus in plus, plus which is greater than 0, 3 to infinity, so f is strictly increasing. Find the intervals in which the function this, fx equal to sine 3x, x belongs to 0 to pi by 2, is increasing or decreasing. So sine x, sine 3x is there, just take the derivative, f dash x, that is 3 cos 3x. Means sine 3x is cos 3x, then 3x differential is 3 cos 3x. If you put f dash x equal to 0, you get, if you place this equal to 0, you get cos 3x equal to 0. So this 3x will be equal to, because 3x equal to pi by 2 and 3 pi by 2. In which interval? 0 to pi by 2. Okay. So when 3x is equal to this, x will be what? Divide this by 3. You get two values, pi by 6 and pi by 2, because 3x belongs to this, so we have to take the value, because these two values we know, cos 3x will be 0 in this range, but because 3x is this, is equal to this, x will be equal to pi by 6, we have divided this by 3. So this point x equal to pi by 6 divides now the interval into two in various parts, that is 0 to pi by 2, and then pi by, then 0 to pi by 6, and pi by 6 to pi by 2. 0 to pi by 2 is the interval given. We have pi by 6 inside. So 0 to pi by 6 is one interval. Pi by 6 to pi by 2 will be second interval. This is how. First interval, second interval. So we see, if you place the value, you can place the boundary values also. F dash x will be greater than 0 for all which x belongs to 0 to pi by 6 first range. So x below, which x is between 0 to pi by 6. And 3x will be what? 0 to pi by 2. Okay, so f dash x is less than 0 for all x which belongs to the second party, that is pi by 6 to pi by 2. So x belongs to these two, so 3x will be, you just multiply 3 both sides, it will be between pi by 2 and 3 pi by 2. So f is strictly increasing in this and strictly decreasing in this. And also this function is continuous at x equal to 0 and x equal to pi by 6. So we know by theorem we have just seen, f is increasing in this range and decreasing in, you can say, domain, you know, at that range. I am just saying that this is the interval. Find the intervals in which the function f is given by this, which is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. What you have to do here is, because the interval is very important. Fx is this, take f dash x. This will be sine x is cos x is minus sine x. Now put this equal to 0. Sin x becomes equal to cos x. F dash x we have put as equal to 0. Sin x becomes equal to cos x. So when sin x equal to cos x, that means x has to be pi by 4 or 5 pi by 4, because we are trying to find out the values in the interval 0 to 2 pi. So there are only two values, pi by 4 and 5 pi by 4, where sin x becomes equal to cos x. So at x equal to pi by 4, x equal to 5 pi by 4, actually this is dividing the interval. There are three intervals which are being made. The interval 0 to 2 pi by 2 pi is now divided into three disjoint intervals. So the three disjoint interval, f dash x will be greater than 0 in this, f is strictly decreasing in this interval and this interval, right? So f dash x is less than 0 in this, so it is strictly decreasing in this. So in this, in these two, it is strictly increasing, in this it is strictly decreasing. You just have to place the value, boundary values you can place, and you say that it is less than 0 or greater than 0. You will easily find out whether it is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. So these are the three partitions, actually 0 to pi by 2. The f dash x will be greater than 0, here less than 0, here greater than 0, here strictly increasing, strictly decreasing, strictly increasing. Tangents and normal, we are going to see how differentiation will help us to find the equation of the tangent line and normal line to a curve at a given point. So if this is your curve, then this is the tangent, and perpendicular to this tangent is the normal. So if this point is, say, x0, y0, then equation of a line, first of all, passing through a given point x0, y0, whose slope is m, is given by y minus y0 is equal to mx minus x0, and slope of the tangent at any function, say this is y equal to fx, at point x0, y0 will be nothing but dy by dx. So this is the slope. Dy by dx is the slope, that is, it is nothing but f dash x0, that is the differential at x0 point. And the equation of the tangent to the curve, this one, y equal to fx, if you assume this to be y equal to fx, this one, then y minus y0 will be equal to, this is m. So m is f dash at x0. The differential at x0 is the m, that is the slope, and the equation will be given by this. So we have a tangent, we have a curve to the tangent at this point, and this is the normal line, which is actually perpendicular to the tangent. And since we know, if two lines are perpendicular, this is the slope of this line is m1 and slope of this line is m2, then m1 into m2 will be equal to minus 1. So as we know, the slope of tangent is m1, slope of normal will be minus 1 by m1, and m1 was what? This was equal to minus 1. M1 is what? F dash 0. So for the normal, the slope will be minus 1 by f dash 0. So this is how. This should not be equal to 0. So the normal to the curve the curve y equal to fx at x0, y0 will be equal to y minus y0 is equal to minus 1 by f dash x0. This is the perpendicular line to the tangent, which is called the normal. And x minus x0, these are the points. So you can just rearrange it. This is the equation of the line. See, let me tell you that this f dash 0 or f dash x, dy by dx, or tan theta, all these are the tangent, slope, gradient. So there may be certain cases, say these are two cases. What can happen if slope of the tangent is 0? That means tan theta is 0. Tan theta is what? It is the slope. That means theta has to be 0. Theta has to be 0, that means this line is parallel to x axis. So what will be the y distance if this is x0, y0? This is y0. Y equal to y0 will be the equation of the line. Now, if we talk about the line which is parallel to y axis, so if the theta tends to pi by 2, tan theta tends to infinity, which means the line, which tangent line, is perpendicular to the x axis now. So any line which is perpendicular to axis will be parallel to y axis. So the distance should be x0. If this is the point x0, y0, this is the x0 only. Okay. So the equation of the tangent at x0, y0 is given by x equal to x0. Find the slope of the tangent to the curve, this one, at x equal to 2. So what we will do here is, we will find dy by dx of x cube minus x, that will be 3x square minus 1. At 2 means you just place 2 here, that will be 11. This is the slope, this is the tan theta, and this one is the gradient. Find the point at which the tangent to the curve, this one, has its slope, this one. So we'll differentiate it and put it equal to 2 by 3, and we'll try to find out the points. So dy by dx, that is differential of this, this is equal to this. I hope that you'll be able to do the differential, and you just have to keep or place it equal to 2 by 3. And this is equal to, if you solve it, x equal to 3. Now x equal to 3 is there, so I just put x equal to 3 in this equation, you get y equal to 2. So x equal to 3, y equal to 2, this is the required point. Find the equation of all lines having slope 2 and being tangent to the curve, this one. So slope is this, all the lines, and which are tangent to this curve. First of all, we'll find out the dy by dx. That will be 2. We just have to rearrange first and then take the dy by dx, that is 2 by x minus 3 whole square. Now the slope is 2, so we just equate this with 2 and try to solve this equation. That will be, because this is x minus 3 whole square equal to 1. So x minus 3 will be equal to 2 values, plus minus 1. So 2 values will come. If you place plus 1 first, then minus 1 first. So 2 and 4 will come. Now we have x, and because this 2 and 4 has come, and this is what? This is just, we have known the m. And 2 and 4, if you take x equal to 2, y equal to 2, x equal to 4, see, these are the x values. These are the x values, and you have to find the equation of all the lines. All the lines. So x and y is known. How can you find x and y? Just place these value x, 2 in this equation, you get y. You place 4 here, you get y. So 2 points you got, and the slope is also given. So if you place x equal to 2, y equal to 2, so this is the 1 point, 2, 2. If you place x equal to 4 in the equation, you get minus 2. So this is x1, y1, x2, y2. And slope is also given. So first equation will be y minus y1, m is slope, which is given in the question, and x minus x1. This is first equation. Now the second points are these. Okay, 4 minus 2. So y minus y1, m is given as same, this will be same as 2, and x minus x1, this one. So you get y minus 2x plus 10 equal to 0. Find the points on the curve, this, right, which the points are parallel to x-axis and parallel to y-axis. So this is your equation, just differentiate it and take dy by dx. Dy by dx on the one side and others on the right hand side. So we want to find the tangents which are parallel to x-axis. Parallel to x-axis means like this. And parallel to y-axis means like this. So what you will do here is, tangent is parallel to x-axis when the tan theta is equal to 0. Tangent is 0. That is dy by dx is equal to 0. Which is possible only when x is equal to 0. So x equal to 0 gives, if you put x equal to 0 in this equation, you get y equal to plus minus 5. So you have two points, 0, 5. One time you take 0 and plus 5. One time you take 0 and minus 5. So these are two points. How about the second one? Here, what you will do here is, the slope of the normal is 0. So if this is the tan theta, what will be the slope of the normal? Minus 1 by this one. Minus 1 by this one. So you get 4y by 25x. You have just placed this particular thing below this, minus 1 by this. Because it is the m of the normal will be equal to 1 by minus 1 by the slope of the tangent. So here we get only 0 when y equal to 0. So you place y equal to 0, you get two values of x plus 2 minus 2. Now y equal to 0, But you take 1 time 2, 1 time minus 2. So these are the 2 points here. Find the equation of the tangent to the curve this at the point where it cuts the x-axis. When it cuts the x-axis, means y equal to 0 here. Y is equal to 0. This is dy. Just find dy by dx. I hope you will be able to find out the dy by dx. This is quite easy. And then once you find out dy by dx, this is the equation. Okay. So on the x-axis, as I just said, y will be equal to 0. So y will be equal to 0. If you place y equal to 0 here, you get a value of x in this equation only. Y equal to 0, you get x equal to what? X equal to 7 if you solve it. See, y equal to 0, that means x minus 2, that is this. If this is 0, this is going to be 0. This will be multiplied here. So x minus 7 equal to 0, that gives you x equal to 7. That is why if you place y equal to 0 in this equation, you get x equal to 7. So 7 and 0 are our point. Now, let us differentiate this equation, dy by dx, like this. Now place 7, 0. That will give you the slope at 7, 0. So this will be the slope. You just place 7, 0 here. You get 1 by 20. Now you have 2 points, means 1 point and slope, that is 1 by 20. So y minus y1, that is y minus y1, m is 1 by 20, and x minus x1. So this is your equation. Find the equation of the tangent and normal to the curve this at 1, 1. First of all, you have to differentiate it. You have to find out dy by dx. Take all others on the right hand side. I hope you will be able to do the differential. Now, why this 1 and 1 is 1 and 1 is given? Because the point is 1, 1. So place y1 and x1 here. You get dy by dx like this. This will be minus 1. The equation of the tangent will be, because the points are given, y minus y1 is equal to m x minus x1. This is your equation. Now the slope of the normal would be minus 1 by the slope of the tangent, which is equal to minus 1. So this is equal to 1. Now again, you can just use this equation. Y minus y1, x minus x1 here, and this m is 1. So this is the equation of the normal. This is the equation of the tangent. This is the equation of the normal, that is perpendicular to the tangent. Find the equation of the tangent to the curve this at point t equal to pi by 2. So x is given like this because this is a parametric form. Y equal to, y is in terms of t, x is in equal to, which is in terms of t. So here what we'll do here is, first of all we'll find dx by dt and then dy by dt. I hope you'll be able to differentiate it. Then just divide this by this. This by this. You get some equation. This is dy by dx, that is, this is your what? This will be your tan theta or dy by dt or slope. Now this t is pi by 2. So t at pi by 2, just place value t by this pi by 2 in the slope values. Here you have to place pi by 2 here. In this t you have to place pi by 2. So now at t equal to pi by 2, x is equal to a and y equal to 0. X is equal to a and y equal to 0. How did you get it? See, this you have to place here. At t equal to pi by 2, x will be what? Because you have to see sin pi by 2 is what? Sin 0 is 0, sin pi by 2 is 1. And this cos pi by 2. Cos 0 is 1 and kind of cos pi by 2 is 0. So you get a and x equal to a and y equal to 0 because we have placed in the original equation. So now we have the points, we have the slope. So y minus y0 is equal to m x minus x0, that will be y equal to 0. Approximations means how we are going to use the differentials to approximate values of certain quantities. See, if this is a function from d to r, d belongs to this real number. This is given by a function y equal to fx. Let us denote very small value, delta x, very small value, or that is increment to x. That is, if you increase x to delta x, x from delta x, what will be the delta y? What will be the change in y? Because y equal to fx. Y is dependent on x. When you place x, you get y. When you place x plus delta x, you get some delta y. So how to find this delta y? That will be nothing but the function value at x plus delta x, that is the increment value added, minus the value of the function itself. Like this. Just understand this graph very carefully, because this is going to give you actual idea of what we are going to do in the problems. See, you have increased x from this to this. That is, this is very small dx, or you can say delta x. Delta is ds, they are equal. Now, when you add some delta x to this function, this y also increases, and this will be equal to delta y. So, for delta x, a delta y will be, means for delta x, the change in y, for change in x, this will be the change in y, very small. But if this is dx, what will be the dy? This one, because this is your tangent and this is your curve. So when you take the tangent and curve, actually this will be your dy and this will be your dx, but delta y is this one total. This is very small, this portion is very small. So we will in our discussion, we will just ignore this, because very small dy, because as you see, delta y is greater than dy. But because this value is small, we can assume dy also to be equal to delta y, right? So the differential of x, which is denoted by dx, we are assuming it to be very small increment, which is delta x. So the differential of y, because there is change in dx also, and denoted by dy, the differential of dy will be equal to what? Dy by dx is what? This is f dash x. So what will be dy? It will be f dash x into dx. So now you can write dy will be equal to f dash x is what? Dy by dx. And this for dx, this small dx, will write delta x. Very small. So this dx is equal to delta x, because this is a very small increment. And dy, we have a very good approximation, as I just suggested in the graph or in the figure. The dy also can be taken as delta y. That small increment can be ignored. So for geometrical meaning, we have just seen the diagram. Now, you will understand what we just learned better when we do the actual problem, that is 36.6. Here the thing is that you are aware of 36. This is 6. Under root of 36 is 6. This is known. So how to get this 0.6 value? So this 0.6 is nothing but, we'll take it as delta x. Okay. So this y equal to under root x is our function. X is what? 36. Let us assume delta x to be very small value, that is 0.6. So how delta y can be find out? The function of value at the function at x plus delta x, subtracting the value of x at the x, the value of function y, the y x plus root x minus root x. So what is this 36.6? What is this? You know this. X plus delta x is 36.6. Under root 36 is, we know, 6. Now you can just take this 6 here. So under root 36.6 will be 6 plus delta y. So if you are able to find out this delta y, you will be able to find out the value of under root 36.6. But we have just seen in our discussion, dy will be equal to dy by dx into delta x. What is dy by dx? Just differentiate this function, which will be equal to 1 by 2 root x. And what is delta x? 0.6. What is the value of x? This is 36. Place it here and just you get 0.05. So what will be the value of root 36.6? Just add this dy here. That will be 6 plus 0.05, this one, and you get 6.05. So this is the way how we find out the approximate value using the differential. See, we'll take one more example. This is 25, that is cube root of 25 is there. Here the thing is, we are aware of cube root of 27, which we know as 3. Okay, this is very clear, because 27 is 3 cube, and cube root of, this is cube root. Cube root of 27 is 3. Okay, now we have to write in such a way, because here delta x is what? 2, or you can say minus 2. Because 27 minus 2 will be equal to 25. So this will be delta x. So y equal to x 1 by 3, that is cube root of x, is our function. X is what? 27. Delta x is minus 2 here, because when we subtract 27 with 2, you get the 25. So what will be delta y? delta y value will be nothing but the value added delta x minus the actual value. So this will be x plus delta x, that is 27 minus 2 will be 25, and x is originally 27. So this is 3. Now you take 3 here. So what will be the 25 1 by 3, that is 25 cube root of 25? It will be equal to delta y plus 3. So if you are able to find this delta y, you will be able to find out the cube root of 25. We know dy is dy by dx delta x. Differentiate this expression, you get this. Now delta x is minus 2, place it here. And just solve it with x equal to 27. You solve it, you get minus 0.074 and take it here. 3 plus or 3 minus 0.0074 will be your cube root of 25, that is equal to 2.926. Find the approximate value of 3.02. fx is this. So 3.02, so we'll take x is equal to 3 and delta x equal to 0.02. this will be your delta x. So when we already have this function, what we can do, x and delta x are known. So what will be f 3.02, that is fx plus delta x. Now this place this x plus delta x in this here, in place of x, place x plus delta x and just open it up. Now what is delta y, which is the function f x plus delta x minus f x, right? So what will be f x plus delta x, that will be, take it here, delta y plus f x. Okay, now here we know that dx is nothing but delta x and dy is nothing but delta y. So f x in place of delta y, we can write f dash x delta x, that you know, you just saw that this delta y will be equal to dy by dx and delta x, like this. So for, and this is nothing but f dash x. So for delta y, you can write f dash x into delta x, what we have done here. And now f 3.02 is what, approximately fx, that is this one, plus f dash x is what, just differentiate this, you get 6x plus 5. And what is delta x? 0.02. You solve it, you get 45.36. You have to place x equal to 3 and delta x equal to 0.02. This is 45.46. Find the approximate change in the value of v of a cube of side x meters caused by increasing the side by 2%. See, this has come in the 2017 board paper. So this question has exactly come. So kindly just concentrate on this. See, v is, because you know the volume of cube, that is side cube, v equal to x cube. And we know that dv by dv equal to dv delta v, or you can also say delta v. Delta v or dv is equal to dv by dx and delta x. Dv by dx is what? Take differential of x cube, that will be 3x square. This will be delta x. And 3x square, delta x is what? This is the 2%. So x caused by increasing the side by 2%. So if x is the side, what will the 2% of this, that will be equal to 0.02. let me tell you, x into 2 by 100, which will be equal to 0.02x. now place delta x here, you get 3x square into 0.02, and this will be 0.06x cube. This will be the approximate change in the volume. If the radius of a sphere is measured in as 9 cm with an error this, find the approximate error in calculating the volume. So let us take r as the radius of the sphere and delta r is the error in measuring the radius. This is what we have to, first we have to assume so that we can find out the value. This delta r, as we have assumed r and delta r, because it is given, r is 9, and delta r, the change is 0.03. So delta r will be 0.03. What will be the volume? Volume is nothing but 4 by 3 pi r cube of a sphere. So dv by dr is what? 4 by 3, that is 4 pi r square. Now you know delta v or dv equal to dv by dr into delta r. Dv by dr you just place as 4 pi r square, and delta r, 4 pi r square, r is 9, delta r is 0.03. Place it here, you get 9.72 pi. So this is the approximate error in calculating the maxima volume and minima. We will see the concepts of derivatives, how to compute the maximum and minimum value. that is of various function, we will try to find out the turning points of the graph of a function, and then we'll see how that graph or those points where the graph reaches its highest or lowest locally also, and then we'll also go about discussing the absolute maximum and absolute minimum. Okay, this is applied in various problems and sciences. So just consider the problem, daily life problem, that the profit from a grove of orange trees is this, given by this function, where this a and b are constants, and x, this x is the number of orange trees per acre. How many trees per acre will maximize the profit? As another example, a ball thrown into the air from a building which is 60 meter high, it travels along a path given by this, where x is the horizontal distance from the building and hx is the height of the ball. So what is the maximum height of the ball will reach? An Apache helicopter of enemy is flying along the path given by this curve. This is the curve. Helicopter is flying. A soldier placed at this point wants to shoot the helicopter when it is nearest to him. What is the nearest distance? And we are going to solve this. We are going to solve this when I explain you the concepts of minima and maxima. So all these problems have certain things in common. And what is the common thing? Here we need to find out the maximum and minimum value of the function. These are the functions which are being given, right? So we'll see the local minima, maxima, and thereby going to the absolute maxima and minima. So first of all, let us define it. If we have f as a function which is defined on certain interval, say a comma b, this is the interval. So f is said to have a maximum value in this I, in this interval. If there exists some c point in this interval, some I in this interval, such that the value, that is fc, is greater than or equal to the function itself for all x which belongs to I, the number this fc is called the maximum value of f at point c, and this is called, and this c is called the point of maximum value of f in this interval I. Again, f is said to be or said to have a minimum value in this range, or in this interval, if there exists a point c in I such that this fc is less than or equal to fx for all x which belongs to this interval, and the number fc is called the maximum value of f, and the point c is called the point of minimum value of f. Now f can have maximum, minimum, but it can also have there can be another instance. F is said to have an extreme value in I if there exists a point c in again this interval such that fc is either a maximum value or a minimum value, either a maximum or minimum value. So here the number fc is called the extreme value of f in this interval, and the point c is called the extreme point. So these are the graphs, all those things which we have discussed. See, this is the interval, this is A, this is B. Just taking an example, we have FC. So this FC is having the highest value here. See, there is no which is higher than this at this point C. Here, see, this is the lowest point, this is the highest point. It is quite visible here. And in this case, we have this point as the minimum as you compare any of these points. So we are calling this as a local maxima. We are calling this as a local minima. And this is for these two, we have minima also, maximum also. Let us find the minimum and maximum value. The function is given by fx is equal to x square. So the fx equal to x square, this graph of this function is shown by this graph. Okay, this is the graph. So see, at x equal to 0, if you put x equal to 0 here, what fx will be? It will be 0. X square, that is 0 square, is what? 0. So you are this graph shows that fx equal to 0 at x equal to 0, and fx is greater than or equal to 0 for all x which belongs to R. See, there is no value which is negative. This graph is above x axis, so there is no point where fx is less than 0. So the maximum, the minimum value of f is nothing but is at 0. And the point of minimum value of f is nothing but x equal to 0. And this is also observed that it has no maximum value, because there is no point where you can stop. This can go all along, you know, this is infinite. But if you restrict here, like if you restrict to certain domain, say certain domain, then you can find out the maximum value also. So I'm just saying that if you restrict this to minus 2, say minus 2 and 1, now you can get the value, because you can place minus 2 in this graph or this function, because minus 2 into square, that is 4. If you place 1 here, it will be 1 square, that is 1. So 4 and 1, which is the maximum, you get 4 as the maximum value. And the 1 as the, you can, 1 and 4 you compare, you don't say that it is 1, because 1 is not a minimum value, because minimum value you have already found, it is 0. Now let us find the minimum and maximum value of f, where fx is given by mod x. This is the modulus function. And we know the graph of this modulus function. This is the graph. So as we observe here, again the 0 is the minimum value. Is the minimum value. For f, if you place x equal to 0 in this function fx, so it will be mod of 0, that will be 0 only. So fx is greater than or equal to for all x belongs to R, and it is 0 at x equal to 0. So this function has a minimum value 0, and the point of minimum value of this is x equal to 0, as we just saw. And there is no maximum value again, because this can go all along, you know, there is infinitely it can extend. So there is no point of maximum also. But if we restrict it, say if I restrict it to minus 2 and 1, there is nothing here. The graph is from, it extends till here and here. So now you can put this minus 2 value, and this is mod. So you get 2. You can also place this value 1, mod is 1. So you get 2. So this is maximum at minus 2. Now you get the maximum value. Find the maximum and minimum value of this function, fx equal to x, where x belongs to 0 to 1. See, this is the graph. This is the graph. So 0 to 1, this is 0 and 1. This x is from 0 to 1. Here, this graph is increasing, strictly increasing. See, it is strictly increasing. And from this graph, this function, it should have a maximum value, which is a point which is closest to 0 on the right, and maximum value, this is minimum value at here, and maximum value here, which is closest to this one. Okay. So are these points available? Yes, these points are available, but there is a catch. It is not possible to locate such points. Why? See, this is 0, 1. That means these two are not inclusive. If we would have done square bracket 0, 1, that means this is, round bracket means 0 and 1 are not included. Since 0 and 1 are not included, we cannot find the value at 0 and 1. That is, if a point x0 which is closest to 0, then we can always find some point x0 by 2 which is less than x0. And if this x0 belongs to 0 to 1. Also, if x1 is closest to 1, this x plus 1, 1, that is the next value divided by 2, is greater than x1, for which x1 belongs to 0 to 1. Therefore, this function has neither the maximum value nor the minimum value at 0, 1. But if you have done this, if 0 and 1 are included, then the maximum value is, of course, this one, minimum value is this. See, the discussion is like this. This, when you include 0 and 1, then you have the minimum value at x equal to 0 and maximum value at x equal to 1, which is 1. And minimum value of 0 at x equal to 0. So every monotonic function assumes its maximum minimum value at the endpoints of the domain of definition of the function. That is these two values, you know, the extremes. So every continuous function on a closed interval has a maximum and minimum value. Monotonic, by this we mean that in any interval, this one, f is either increasing or it is decreasing, monotonic. Maximum and minimum values of function is defined in closed interval. We just saw like this. Now let us see the turning values. What are the turning values or turning point? Just see that in this graph we have A, B, C, D. At A, the graph is all these points are standstill. But if you take this point, it is decreasing. At this point, it is increasing. So this is the minimum point. At this point, it just before that, here it is increasing. Whereas at this point, it is decreasing. So we can conclude that this is the maximum point. Again, the same logic goes for this is minimum, this is maximum, right? So what we are trying to do here is, we'll try to find out the neighborhood values. In this, we'll try to find out for this point neighborhood values. If this A and C in this graph, they are regarded as a local minimum value or relative minimum value, and B and D are local maximum value, that is relative maximum value. So the local maximum value and local minimum value of the function are known as local maxima and local minima. So these two points where a dip is there, these are local minima, and points where, or the graph where there is no dip but it will have a hill type of representation, then we say that it is local maxima. This is local minima. Let us define it now. F is a real valued function, and let C be an interior point in domain of F. Then C is called the point of local maxima when, local minima when, and point of inflection when. I'll tell you. It is called the point of local maxima if there is some h which is greater than 0. Some h which is greater than 0. What we are talking about is, we are at C. This is h very small value, which is h very small value where h tends to what? H tends to 0, right? Very small value. So now C minus h and C plus h, if x is in between this C minus h and C plus h, this fc should be greater than or equal to fx. The value of C at function fc should be greater than or equal to fx. So this value fc is called the local maximum value. Again, with the same discussion, if you take this graph, this is C. So this is C minus H, very small value, and this is C plus H, very small value. This is C minus H, this is C plus H. So if H is greater than 0 and C is called the point of local minima, if FC is less than or equal to FX, FC is less than or equal to FX for any point which belongs to XC minus H and C plus H, the value FC is called the local minimum value FF. And if you see it geometrically, see, this is the geometric interpretation. Here we have f dash x greater than 0, f dash x less than 0. Means here the slope is increasing. F dash x is nothing but the slope or gradient or divided by dx, or you can say tan theta. It is increasing here at C minus h. Here it is at C plus h, it is decreasing. So whenever it is increasing and then decreasing, at this point, just before that it is increasing, just after that it is decreasing, then it is the point. This point is called the local maxima. Similarly, the case is here. If it is decreasing and then it is increasing at C minus h and C plus h, then this is known as the point of local minima. That is what we try to explain here. If at x equal to C, the point of local maxima of f, then the graph of f around C is what we have to see. So the function f is increasing, that is if f dash x greater than 0 in C minus h and s and c, and if it is decreasing, that is f dash x should be less than 0 in this interval c to c plus h, that is from c minus h to c it should be increasing, from c to c plus h it should be decreasing. That is why at this point it should be a point of maximum. If at c minus h it is decreasing and at C plus H it is increasing, then this is the point of local minima, right? I hope you got the idea. Same thing is explained here. Now we'll have a theorem. Let f be a function defined on an interval I. Suppose c belongs to I, be any point. So f has a local maxima or local minima at x equal to c. Then this either f dash c has to be 0 or f is not differentiable at c. This is a kind of function and this is called the point of inflection. Here, okay, one more thing. The converse of this theorem need not to be true, because the point at which the derivative vanishes need not to be a point of local maxima or minima. Let us take this function fx equal to x cube. Here f dash x is what? 3x square. If you place 0 here, f dash x is 0. But 0 is neither a point maxima nor a minima, because you have minimum value, you have various value which are below this, you have various value which are above this. So no, neither maxima nor minima this point is. But still it is giving f dash 0. The differential at 0 is 0. So this point C is in any domain function, domain of a function f, which is either f dash equal to 0 or it is not differentiable. This point is called the critical point of f, critical point. So if f is continuous at C and f dash C equal to 0, then there exists some h which is greater than 0, such that f is differentiable in this interval, C minus h to C plus h. So we now have some working rule to find the local maxima or points of local minima using only the first derivatives. First of all, what we have to do? Let f be the function defined in an open interval I. F is continuous at critical point C in I, then this f dash x, it should change or change a sign from positive to negative as x increases through C. If f dash x, that is the derivative of f, is greater than 0 at every point sufficiently close to left of C, and f dash c is less than 0, that is here c minus h and here c plus h, at every point sufficiently close to or to the right of C, then this is called the maxima. Now f dash x, same thing for the minima, but the values will change. Means this f dash x changes sign from negative to positive as increases x increases through C. Means here. So f dash x is less than 0 here, which is close to or left of C, and here f dash c is greater than 0, which is close to or the right of C. So this is called the point of minima. So f dash x does not change the point, but it does not change sign as x increases through C. Now if it doesn't change the sign, then C is neither a point of local maxima nor a point of local minima. This point is actually called as point of inflection. What we call point of inflection. So if C is a point of local maxima of F, then FC is called the local maximum value of F. In the same way, C is a point of local minima of F, FC will be called as the local minimum value of F. So this is the proper representation. This is the point of local maxima, local minima, and these are the point of point of local minima, and this is the point of non-differentiability. This is not differentiable. Again, this point is also not differentiable, but this is the point of local minima. Find all the points of local maxima and local minima of this function. So this is the function. Let us take f dash x. F dash x is this, and put f dash x equal to 0. We place this equal to 0, x will be 1, x equal to minus 1. So this at x equal to 1 and x equal to minus 1, f dash x will be 0. So these are two points which are critical points, and in this we'll get some local minima or maxima. So let us start with x equal to 1. We'll place x equal to 1 in this equation. So basically we'll place it here in the f dash x, right? So the values which are close to 1 and to the right of 1, f dash x is greater than 0, and the value which is close to 1 and left of 1, if you take any value which is left of 1, f dash x is less than 0. So first derivative at x equal to 1 is the point of local minima and local maxima. the value is f1 equal to 1. If you place now in the actual equation 1, you get 1. When you take x equal to minus 1, so just note that this f dash x is greater than 0 for value which is close to or left, that is c minus h of minus 1, and f dash x is less than 0 for value which is close to and which is right of minus 1. That is the first derivative test, that is x equal to minus 1. It gives you the point of local maxima, and the local maximum value will be, you will place minus 1 in the actual equation. It will give you 5. So close to 1, to right, that is 1.1, greater than 0, 0.9, less than 0. This f dash x, we are talking about f dash x. So now, what it is happening? When it is less than 0, that is f dash x is less than 0, and then f dash x is greater than 0, greater than 0, less than 0. Here less than 0 and greater than 0. For the point minus 1, we have taken to the right of minus 1 and we have taken the value of minus the left of minus 1, which is minus 1.1. So you get the maxima and minima. Find all the points of local maxima and local minima of this function. So this is fx. Let us find f dash x. F dash x is this. Let us make it some square type. Then keep it to 0. So x will be 1. We have this point. We will check. We will check at x equal to 1. So x equal to 1 is the only critical point here. So let us find out the maxima or minima. So this f dash x is greater than or equal to, for all x belong to R. If this f dash x is greater than 0, that means if you put the value which is close to 1 or left or right, it will always be 1. So the from the first derivative, x equal to 1 is neither local maxima nor the local minima. Actually, x equal to 1 is the point of inflection here. We'll try to give you one more example of, or we'll extend the discussion. We'll apply some more rule, that is the second derivative test. How to check for local minima or maxima with second derivative test. So if f is a function defined in interval I and c belongs to this interval, then f is twice, and this f should be twice differentiable at c, then x equal to c is the point of local maxima if f dash c equal to 0, and double differentiation at c is less than 0. So this fc is called the local maximum value of f. When x equal to c is a point of local minima, if f dash c equal to 0, but f double dash c here is greater than 0, it was less than 0 here. In this case, this fc is the local minimum value of f. If the test failed, that is f dash c equal to 0, but f double dash c, that is double derivative, is also 0, then we'll go back to the first derivative test to find whether c is the point of local maxima, local minima, or point of inflection. So this twice differentiable means second order derivative of f also exists at c. Find the local minimum value of the function this, local minimum value. So this is the graph. If you make the graph, this is the local minimum value. So as you see, this is the local minimum value from the graph. So just see that this function is not differentiable at x equal to 0. Here it is not differentiable. So the second derivative test will fail. Will not go to the second derivative. So let us do it with the first derivative only. And what is the critical point? Critical point is 0. Critical point is 0. Now let us take a value which is left of 0. That is some value which is left of 0, say 0.9. So this fx 3 minus x, if you place it here, f dash x, and if you take the f dash x, that will be equal to minus 1. Because mod x here, if you take, you are taking the value which is less than 0, which is less than 0, so it will be the minus value. This will be my 3 minus x, right? And here it will be 3 plus x. Again, if you take a value which is right, so right means value which is greater than 0 is positive, so it will be 3 plus x. So in this case, you will get minus 1. In this case, you get f dash x equal to 1, which here is negative, here positive. So by first derivative test, we see at x equal to 0, this is the point of local maxima of f. And local minimum value is what? You get
3. If you place here at x equal to 0, you get value as 3. Find the local maxima and local minimum value of the function f, which is given by this. So let us take fx, find out the f dash x, means derivative of this, and just place it at to 0. You see, x equal to 0, x equal to 1 and x equal to minus 2, these are the critical points. Now find out the double derivative, means derivative of this, or double derivative of this, you get this. Now place value 0, 1 and minus 2 in this equation. So you get minus 12, 48 and 84. So where you have to find maximum and minimum value. Here it will be minimum because it is negative. See, I'll show you. Second derivative, the sign will change. By second derivative test, x equal to 0 is the point of local maximum, and local maximum value at x equal to 0 will be what? Just place 0 here. You get some value, that is 12. If you place 1 or minus 2, you will get the positive values, which shows that this positive value, that is double derivative of this, if it is positive, that means it is minimum value or local minimum value. So at 1 and minus 2, at 1 minus 2, you get f1 equal to 7. If you place 1 here, you get 7, f minus 2, you get minus 20. Find all the points of local maxima and local minima of this function. Fx is this, f dash x will be the derivative of this. So 6x minus 1 whole square, and here you place this equal to 0. So x will be 1, this is the critical point. You take f double dash x, means derivative of this. Now here, at this point, if you place x equal to 1, what you get? You get 0. So the second derivative test has failed. f double dash x at x equal to 0, they both are 0. So now we'll go back to the first derivative test. And we have already seen, using the first derivative test, x equal to 1 is neither a point of local minima or maxima, so it is the point of inflection. Find two positive number whose sum is 15 and sum of whose squares is minimum. So if one is x, other will be 15 minus x, and let us square them and add. So one is x, other will be 15 minus x. So sx will be the sum, which is given by x square plus 15 minus x whole square. So you get this. Now let us find out the derivative of this, which will be 4x minus 30. S double dash x is 4. If you differentiate this, you get 4. So this is a positive value. That means you will get a minima, because this is a constant value and a positive value. So there will be a minima. So s dash x equal to 0, if you place this equal to 0, 4x minus 30 equal to 0, you get x equal to 15 by 2. And when you place s double dash, any value you place, you will get always 4. So by the second derivative, at x equal to 15 by 2, you will get a local minima because this is positive. This is greater than 0. So the sum of squares of numbers is minimum when the numbers are 15 by 2, and this is x, this is 15 minus x, that is again 15 by 2. Find the shortest distance of the point 0c from the parabola, this one, where c is between 0 to 5. So let us, first of all, this is the parabola. Let us assume that hk is a point in this parabola. So it will satisfy it. Okay, this is y. So k will be h square, this one. And let us take the distance d as the required distance between hk, this point which we have assumed, and 0c. What is the distance? You know the distance formula, y2 minus y1 whole square plus x2 minus x1 whole square in the root. So this is your distance. Now, k equal to h square, and this is the distance. Now, place h square as k here, this distance. So, it will be under root k plus k minus c whole square. Let us find the differential. This will be the differential. And now, let us put this equal to 0. You will get k equal to 2c minus 1 by 2. And just see that when k is less than 2c minus 1 by 2, take 2k here and just take all on the left hand side, this becomes less than 0. So the first differential is less than 0. And when k is greater than this one, d dash again with this same discussion, this will be greater than 0. So the first derivative test, dk is minimum at k equal to 2c minus 1 by 2. So the distance, required distance will be, you just have to place k equal to 2c minus 1 by 2 in the distance formula as we have just seen. It will be under root 4c minus 1 by 2. Now here, AP, this AP and BQ, these are two vertical poles at A and B. AP is 16 and BQ is 22 and this AB is 20. Then find the distance of point R on AB, this AB, such that RP square, this square plus this square is minimum. So this is whole 20, let us take it as x. So this will be 20 minus x. We'll use the Pythagoras result. PR is what? PR square will be equal to x square plus 16 square. And what will be the PQ square, this RQ square? It will be 20 minus x whole square plus 22 whole square. So if we take this as x, this will be 20 minus x and RP square will be, as I just told you, this will be the Pythagoras theorem. Now let us place the value AR, AP, RB, BQ. These are the values. And this you get as the polynomial or the equation of the graph. See what? X plus RQ square is nothing but this one. Now take the differential. You get 4x minus 40. Now you place it equal to 0. You get x equal to 10. So as double dash x find out, it will be 4. That is the positive value. So you will get the minima. So now second derivative test at x equal to 10, you get a point of local minima. So now at x equal to 10, the value will be minimum. And just place x equal to 10, you will get the
maximum and minimum values of a function in a closed interval. We have seen about this function fx, which is equal to x plus 2. In this open interval, where the 0 and 1 was not included, this function has neither a minimum value or a local minima, or a minimum value or a maximum value or a local maximum. But if we extend this function to the closed interval, this closed interval is represented by this square bracket, which means these values are included. Here 0 and 1 will not be included. Value which is just beyond 0, very very less beyond 0, or just before 1 is included, but 0 and 1 are not included. But here in the closed interval, 0 and 1 is also included. So if we found out the value at f equal to 1 and f equal to 0, we see if we place 1, what will we get? 3. If we place 0, what will we get? 2. So this f1 and f0, this 3 and 2, these are the values and we call them as the absolute maximum or global maximum, because we are taking it at the extremes, at the extremes. Similarly, the value 2, which we have come up with putting 0 at the place of x, this is called the absolute minimum value or global minimum or least value of function f in this interval, which is our closed interval. So when we have this interval, which is the closed interval a and d, so we'll check for the point A and we'll check for the point D, and we'll find the minima and maxima at this point, and also some point C which is between A and D, which will give you FC. This is the representation. This is your A, this is your D, this is the maxima, this is the minima, that is the absolute maxima and minima. But in between we can have various local maxima and local minima. This is the local minima. This is the local maxima. And also it is evident from the graph that FA and FD, these are showing the absolute maximum and minimum value. While the C is showing what, or the point can in between that can show you some sort of local maxima or minima. So we'll have a theorem here. F is a continuous function on an interval I, AB. AB is a interval which we call as a closed interval, where A and B will be included in the computation. So the F has, the absolute maximum value, and f attains it at least once in I. In this, it will at least at one point, it will attain the absolute maximum. So f has the absolute minimum value also, and that also will be attained at least once in this interval, you can say. One more theorem, if f is differentiable function on a closed interval I, and just assume c is some interior point between this interval. This is an interval and you have say interval as a, b. So this, there is certain some point c which is inside this interval, f dot c equal to 0. If this, if you take the derivative and put c, it becomes 0. So f attains the absolute maximum value at c, and f dot c is 0, then f attains its absolute minimum value at c. Okay. So now let us see the working rules how to find the absolute maxima or absolute minima of a function in any closed interval which is given by a, b. These two are inclusive. Working rule is this. We will find all the critical points of f in the interval. We will find the point x how. We will differentiate it and put it to 0. And f, or rather, the second thing can be f is not differentiable. We will take the endpoints also. That means, in between this a, b, this is interval, we will take these two points also and also find other points which are critical, which will make the derivative equal to 0. And all these steps, 1 and 2, will calculate the value of f, that is at a, at b, at all the critical points which we got in between a and b. And we'll identify the maximum and minimum value of f out of all the values which has been computed from a, z, this, this, and b. And then we'll check out which is the maximum, which is the maximum is the absolute maxima, and which is the lowest of all is the local minimum. Find the absolute minimum and maximum value of this function f, which is given by this. Fx is this on the interval 1, 5. So what we will do here is, first we will take fx, then we will find the derivative of fx, that is f dash x. This will be the derivative. We will make it as a factor and we will put it to 0. We get x equal to 3, we get x equal to 2. X equal to 2 and x equal to 3, these are critical points. So 2 and 3 are critical points and 1 and 5 are also there. So 1, 2, 3, 5, these are all the points where we are going to check the maximum value or the minimum value. So we'll take this function and we'll place 1, 2, 3, 5 one by one. 1, 2, 3, 5. And these are the values. And we'll check which is the maximum of all these and which is the maximum of all these. So which is the maximum? Maximum is 56. And we get it at 5. So this 5 is the point of absolute maximum. And this maxima and 56 is the maximum value. The minimum, the point 1 is the point of minima, absolute minima, and 24 is the value of this minimum value. Find absolute maximum and minimum value of this function, this fx, in minus 1 and 1. So these two has to be included, and we'll find all those points which are inside this, which are critical points. For that, we have to differentiate it and we will put it to 0. So this function is fx. F dash x will, I hope that you'll be able to find out the f dash x. Now put it to 0. This can not be 0. So x equal to 0 is also one of the point. This cannot be 0. So x is equal to 0 is a critical point. And 8x minus 1 equal to 1 is equal to 0. That means x is equal to 1 by 8. So we have minus 1, 1, 1 by 8 and 0. These are 4 points which we need to check. Right? 0, 1 by 8, minus 1 and 1. These are the the 1 by 8 and 0, they are critical points. Minus 1 and 1 are the boundary points. So we'll check the value of the function at minus 1, 0, 1 by 8 and 1. And we get this value. What is the minimum? Minimum is minus 9 by 4. And you get at 1 by 8. So 1 by 8 is the point of absolute minima. And the value of the value of the function, that is the minimum value of the function, is minus 9 by 4. And same is the case for the maximum, which is the maximum 18, which you get at minus 1. An Apache helicopter of enemy is flying along the curve given by this. A soldier placed at this wants to shoot down the helicopter when it is nearest to him. Find the nearest distance. So how will do it? First of all, this is the point. And we want to find the point at this curve. So if this is the curve, say, and this is where the soldier is placed. So let us assume this point is the, say, this point is the closest one. So what will be the distance here? Any point on this, if we take x, y will be x square plus 7, right? If x is the x coordinate, y coordinate will be x square plus 1. So these are the points, x and x square plus 7, and these are 3 and 7. So we'll find the distance, simple distance formula, y2 minus y1 means x minus 3 whole square plus x square plus 7 minus 7 whole square. So when we compute it, we get this. And we'll take the, right now, let us not deal with the root, let us go to x minus 3 whole square plus x to the power 4. This will value is the point which we have to see. We'll differentiate this fx and we'll put it to 0. When we put it to 0, we get the point as x equal to 1. And because this has no real root, we just have one point which is x equal to 1 because we are not getting any point out of it. So x equal to 1, let us find the value of the function at x equal to 1, which we get as 5. And what is the f? F is nothing but this only, okay? We are placing it here. So when we take it, this 5. But as I said, we'll take the root also. We just ignore that time, but we'll take root 5. So root 5 is either the maximum or minimum value. Now take under root f0, which is the distance at, because we know that we have just found at x equal to 1, what will be y? Y is x square plus 5, which is, see, this is your equation. So at x equal to 0, y will be equal to 7. What you get here, the root 5 can be either maximum or minimum value. But you have to find at this point, this under root f0. Under root f0 is given by 3. Under root f0, you have to place, take the function, put the value 0, put the value 0, and then you get value 3, which is greater than root 5. That means root 5 is the minimum value of under root fx. So root 5 is the minimum distance between the soldier and the helicopter. We'll take the miscellaneous examples of application of derivatives. A car starts from point P at t equal to 0, second then stops at point Q. The distance x in meters covered by it in t seconds is given by this. Find the time taken by it to reach Q and also find the distance between P and Q. So this is, just consider v to be the velocity of the car at t seconds. V to be velocity. So what dv, I'll tell you. First of all, this dv by dx is what? Velocity. Velocity is the rate of change of the distance, that is dx by dt. Dx by dt. So it gives you 4t minus t square. Just differentiate it, means this one. You just have to differentiate this. Dv by dt, dx by dt, you get t 4 minus t. Now put it to 0. You get two points. Either t will be equal to 0 or t will be equal to 4. So t equal to 0 and t equal to 4. So v equal to 0. We have put 0 at P and also at Q, right? So we have t equal to 0. So at Q, that is t equal to 4, the car will reach the point Q after what? 4 seconds. This time is 4 seconds. So what will be the distance traveled? We place in the actual equation time equal to 4. This t which we got here, 4, you just have to place. Don't worry about this. Just whatever the discussion will be, if you understood it, it is good, otherwise don't worry. You just have to put this 4 in this actual equation, you get the distance 32 by 3. A water tank has the shape of inverted right circular cone with its axis, this is inverted right circular cone with its axis vertical and vertex lowermost here. Its semi-vertical angle is tan inverse 0.5. This alpha is nothing but this is equal to alpha. Water is poured into it at a constant rate of 5 cubic meter per hour. When the rate at which the level of the water is rising, at the instance when the depth of the water is in the tank is 4 meter. So we will take some assumptions. First of all, let R be the radius of the cone, let height be h of the cone, and this is angle alpha which is given here. This angle is tan inverse alpha. So what will be tan alpha? Tan alpha will be nothing but R by h. Okay, so alpha will be what? Tan inverse R by h. But alpha is also tan inverse 0.5, it is given. So 0.5 will be equal to this, R by h will be equal to 0.5. So R becomes h by 2. Now we'll deal with the actual scenario, which is our volume. Volume of the cone is 1 by 3 pi r square h. In place of r, we can write h by 2. So this will be pi h cube by 12. So what will be dv by dt? This is nothing but d by dh of this and then dh by dt. Okay, this and then dh by dt by chain rule. First we'll differentiate it. This will be pi by 4 h square and then dh by dt. But the rate of change of volume v is given. 5 cubic meter per hour. This is given, and also the depth of the water at this is given as 4. So we'll place h equal to 4 and dv by dt equal to 5 meter cube per hour here in this equation. This is dv by dt in this equation. Here we want to find out dh by dt. We will place the value, we get dh by dt as this, and this is the rate of change of water level. A man of height 2 meters walked at a uniform speed of 5 km per hour away from the lamp post, which is 6 meter high. Find the rate at which the length of its shadow increases. This is the scenario. What this A, B, and this is the man, and M. Now let us take this as L and this as S. Right? So what will be AS? This will be L plus S. Now we'll use the triangles, similarity of triangles. First of all, this AM is L, we have assumed. AB is the lamppost. MN is the man at some particular time T. AM is L, this is L. And MS is S. MS is S. But we see here that this triangle MSN is similar to the main triangle ASB. So this MS, that is S, MS by AS, what will be AS? This AS will be L plus S. Will be equal to MN. MN we don't know. By AB, what will be AB? What will be AB? Let us see. So MN by, one more thing. Let me tell you. First of all, this is given that a man of height 2 meter. So the man will be NM. This will be 2. And what will be AB? This is also given, 6. So S is equal to L plus S into, this is 2 by 3, means 2, 3 is 6, 3 I'll take here. 3S will be equal to L plus S. What will be L? It will be 2S. So now we have a relation between this L and S. This is what is being shown here. Okay, L is equal to 2S. L is equal to 2S. Now let us differentiate. dl by dt will be equal to 2 ds by dt. But dl by dt is already given 5 km per hour, constant speed. What will be the shadow? ds by dt will be, this is 5. This will be 5 by 2. ds by dt will be 5 by 2. Find the equation of the normal of the curve, this, which passes through this point. So we have a conic section here. Differentiate this. dy by dt will be equal to x by 2. This is okay. Now let us take a point HK, or assume this HK to be the coordinate of the point of contact of the normal to the curve. That is x square equal to 4y. X square equal to 4y. Now let us place the value HK at dy by dx. Because we will place only x, that is h here. So dy by dx at this point is h by 2. But we know m1 into m2 equal to minus 1. If this is the slope, this is the normal,
then the product will be minus 1. We know the tangent slope. So what will be the slope of the normal? That will be minus 1 by h by 2. What will be this? Minus 2 by h. Minus 2 by h. So the equation of the normal will be y minus y1 is equal to mx minus x1. So we have known that k and h we have taken as, because this curve, the normal and tangent will be the same point. Hk will be this one. So it will lie in the normal also and the tangent also and the curve also. So y minus k will be minus 2 by h x minus h. But we see that this passes through 1, 2. This passes through 1, 2. So we will use this 1, 2. We will place 1, 2 here. And we see there is a relationship now. So now hk lies in the curve also. So h square will be 4k. When we solve these two, we get h equal to 2 and k equal to 1. We need to solve these two. So the equation will be what? Y minus 1 is equal to minus 2 by h is what? 2. Minus 2 by 2 and x minus h is what? 2. You get this equation. This is the equation of the normal. Find the equation of the tangents of the curve, this one, and the interval is this, that are parallel to the line. So x plus 2y equal to 0, so let us write it as y equal to mx plus c. So 2y will be equal to minus x, y will be equal to minus x by 2 plus 0 c. Y equal to mx plus c, so m is what? Minus half. This is the slope of this line. The equation of the tangent and this slope. This slope will be same with the parallel line. But this is the curve. So let us not differentiate dy by dt. I hope you will be able to do this. This is the differential. So I leave it to you how to differentiate it. So the slope is nothing but this one. But we have just seen the slope is minus half also. So let us equate. This has to be equated to minus half. What will be sin x plus y if you just rearrange it? Sin x plus y will be 1. What will be x plus y when it will be 1? See, cos 90, cos pi by 2 is sin 0 is 0 and sin 90 is 1. So sin 90, this is 90, that is pi by 2. So the general solution for this is in 2 by 2, in this range, minus 2 pi to 2 pi. In this range, the general solution will be n pi plus minus 1 to the power n pi by 2. This is the general solution, this is general. There is no explanation for this. This happens. So y equal to cos x plus y, that will be equal to, because the actual was cos x plus y, which will be equal to cos, this is x plus y, we'll place this here and we get equal to 0. We get this equal to 0. But now minus 2 pi to 2 pi, this is the range. So only minus 3 pi by 2 and pi by 2. In this, if we put n here in this, and we'll try to see which values lie between minus 2 pi to 2 pi. There are only two values. So now, if this is x, we can find out the value of y because we have the equation. And this is x, what will be the value of y? So we get two points, xy, x1, y1, x2, y2. And this is this slope. So we'll use this slope, and first of all, we'll use this one, y minus y0 is equal to mx minus x. X1, y1. So this is x2, y2. Now here again, y minus y0, y minus y1 is equal to mx minus pi by 2. So these are the two equations. Find intervals in which the function this is strictly increasing and strictly decreasing. The question is quite simple. You have to take fx, take the f dash x, make it to 0. You have to simplify it. So x equal to 1, x equal to minus 2 and x equal to 3. These are three critical points. So the range will be, or you can say the intervals will be, first of all minus infinity to minus 2, then minus 2 to 1, 1 to 3 and 3 to infinity. These are all the points. So we'll start with first, minus infinity to minus 2. You see, our actual equation is what? This one. F dash x, we have just found that this x is between minus infinity and minus 2. So we have x minus 1 less than 0. We have to check for these three. See, these three, and we have to say see whether this f dash x is less than 0 or greater than 0 in this interval. So if any value between minus infinity and minus 2, these three will give these values. So it will be actually f dash x is less than 0. That means it will give you a negative value. So in this interval here, from here to here, it is strictly decreasing. Now I'll take minus 2 to 1. You put any value between minus 2 to 1, you get x minus 1 like this. These are the signs. So actually, you get f dash x which is greater than 0. So in this interval, it is strictly increasing. Again, for the next interval 1 to 3, in between 1 to 3, place any value, you get these values, that is the signs. So it is less than 0. So 1 to 3, it is strictly decreasing. When you go to 3 to infinite, and you place the values in these two, these three, you get f dash x equal to is greater than 0. So this is strictly increasing in this interval. We have to show that the function f is fx, which is given by tan inverse sin x plus cos x, is always a strictly increasing function is this. So fx is this, we will take the f dash x, which is given by this. I hope you'll be able to differentiate it. This will be this. Okay. Now this 2 plus sin 2x will be greater than 0. This one means this will be always greater than 0 in this range, 0 to pi by 4, because this is in first quadrant, no problem in that. So f dash x is greater than 0. If this is greater than 0, the numerator cos x minus sin x will be greater than 0. That is, cos x will be equal to sin x, that is, cot x will be greater than 0. Cot x is greater than 0, that is, if it is greater than 0, tan x will be less than 1. It is greater than 1. So cot x is greater than 1, tan x will be less than 1, because this is reciprocal. So x between 0 to pi by 4. That is why f dash x will always be greater than 0 in between this. And when the double differential is greater than 0, the function is strictly increasing. A circular disk of radius 3 is being heated. Due to expansion, its radius increases at the rate of this. Find the rate at which its area is increasing when radius is 3.2 cm. First of all, the disk is a circle. So we'll take the radius A and this radius R and A as the area. A is pi r square. So dA by dt will be what? 2 pi r dr by dt. Since we need to approximate here, this is very small. So this delta or dr, small increase in radius dr, can be written as dr by dt into delta t, which is equal to 0.05. But what will be dA can be written? dA can be written as dA by dt into delta t. But delta t is, for this, we can easily write for this, because dr by dt we have just formed. We can put this here, right? And dA by dt is again 2 pi r dr by dt, and dr by dt is 0.05. So this will be 2 pi r into dr by dt into delta t, which is equal to 0.05. R is 3.2, 2 pi is this. You compute this, this will be 0.3205. An open top box is to be constructed by removing equal squares from each corner of a 3 meter by 8 meter rectangular sheet of aluminium and folding up the sides. Find the value of the largest such box. This is the box. Okay. Now this is x, this is x, this is x, this is x. This will be cut and this will be folded. So a box will be like this. What will be the height? Height will be x. This is the height. This is x, this is x. And this total is what? You get 8. So 8 minus x minus x, that is 8 minus 2x will be this length. This will be whole is 3. This is given 3. So this is x, this is x. So 3 minus 2x will be the distance. Now we are aware of the distances or the length, breadth, height. Now let us go to the volume. Volume is what? Volume is length into breadth into height. X into 3 minus 2x into 8 minus 2x. This will be volume, Vx. So this v dash x will be what? Just differentiate it. The critical point will be x equal to 3 and 3, x equal to 2 by 3. But x cannot be equal to 3, because 3 minus 2, x 3x minus 2 will give, see, 3 minus 2x will give what? 3 minus 2 into 2, that will be negative 3, will be give negative value. So we will be not taking this 3, because this will take to another scenario, which is not acceptable. Now v dash x equal to 0, this 3 and 2 by 3, we have eliminated 3, only 2 by 3 is remaining. Now let us put this 2 by 3 in this v double dash x. this gives you minus 28, which is less than 0. So this is the point of maxima. So if we remove a square of side 2 by 3 meter from each corner of the sheet and make a box from the remaining sheet, then the volume of the box obtained will be the largest. Just put in the actual equation 2 by 3, you get the maximum volume. Manufacturer can sell X items at a price of this. The cost price of this is this. Find the number of items he should sell to earn maximum profit. What is the profit? Profit is the cost price minus selling price. So the SX be this, let this be selling price, and CX be the cost price. What is SX? SX is this. 5 minus X by 100, and we have assumed that we have X items. So just multiply it by X. 5x minus x square by 100 is the selling price. What is the cost price? X by 5 plus 500. Now, what is the profit? This will be the subtraction of these two. And just rearrange, you get this. Now, take the differential. You get 24 by 5 minus x by 50. You put this equal to 0. You get x equal to 240. You double differentiate it. You will only get minus 1 by 50, that is negative, so it will be a maxima. 240 will give you the point of maxima, so manufacturer can earn maximum profit if he sells 240 items. Let us summarize the application of derivatives. If a quantity y varies with another quantity x, satisfying certain rule y equal to fx, then dy by dx or f dash x, that is the slope, gradient, m, tan theta, with dy by dx. This represents the rate of change of y with respect to x, and this dy by dx at x equal to 0, that is f dash x0, will actually give you the rate of change of y with respect to x at x equal to x0. If two variables x and y, they are varying with respect to some other variable t, they are not varying with respect to one another, they are varying with respect to some other variable t. So if x equal to ft and y equal to gt, by chain rule, dy by dx will be dy by dt by dx by dt, where this should not be equal to 0. If we have a function f, and in this interval ab, if x1 is less than x2, and you get fx1 is less than equal to fx2, then, or you can say this f dash x is greater than equal to 0, then f is increasing here. If x1 is less than x2, which lies between a and b, you get fx1 which is greater than or equal to fx2. Then this is decreasing in AB. Or you can also say f dash x is less than or equal to 0. The equation of a tangent at x0, y0 for this curve y equal to fx will be y minus y0, x minus x0 here. And this is the m, tan theta or gradient or slope dy by dx at x0, y0. If dy by dx does not exist at this point, then the tangent at this point will be parallel to y-axis, parallel to y-axis, and the equation will be nothing but x equal to x0. The similar case, if tangent to the curve y equal to fx at x equal to x0 is parallel to x-axis, then dy by dx will be 0. Equation of a normal to the function or to a curve y equal to fx at the point x0, y0 will be given by y minus y0, x minus x0. This is what m, which is nothing but minus 1 by the dy by dx of the slope. If dy by dx at point x0, y0 is 0, then the equation of the normal will be x equal to x0. If dy by dx differential at point x0, y0 does not exist, then the normal is nothing but parallel to the x-axis. That is, parallel to the x-axis, and this is given by y equal to y0. Now, approximation. If y equal to fx, let this delta x be small increment in x, and delta y will be the increment in y corresponding to the increment delta x. So delta y will be given by fx plus delta x minus fx. So dy will be given by f dash x into dy, because dy by dx is nothing but f dash x. But here you can write dy by dx and delta x. Dy will be equal to dy by dx delta x. This is a good approximation for delta y. Dx equal to delta x, because this is very small, and we denote dy by also equal to delta y. If you have a point c in the domain of a function f, where this f dash x, f dash c equal to 0 or f is not differentiable, this is called the critical point of f.
first derivative test. If f be a function defined on any open interval I, and let f be the continuous at critical point c, then f dash x changes sign from positive to negative as x increases through c if f dash x is greater than 0 at every point which is very close, sufficiently close to the left of c, and f dash x is less than 0 for every point sufficiently close to and right of c, that is left of c and right of c, this is c. Recall, this is the point of maxima. This is maxima. In this case, minima, if f dash x change sign from negative to positive as x increases through c. So f dash x is less than 0 at every point sufficiently close and left of c. This is c, left of c. And f dash x is greater than 0 at every point sufficiently close and right of c. So c is the local minima. If f dash x does not, if it is like this, it does not change sign as an x increases through c, then c is neither a point of local maxima nor a point of local minima. In fact, such a point is called point of inflection. Second derivative test. Second derivative test, if f is a function defined on any interval I and c belongs to I, this f is twice differentiable at c, then x equal to c is the point of local maxima if f dash is 0 and f double dash c is less than 0. In a similar fashion, f dash c is equal to 0 but f double dash c is greater than 0, then it will have local minima. If this test fails, f dash c is also 0 and f double dash c is also 0, then we go back to the first derivative test and c is a point of maxima, minima or a point of inflection. What are the working rules for finding absolute maxima or minima? We first find the critical points, all the critical points of f in this interval. We find points x where either this is 0, derivative is 0 or f is not differentiable. We take the endpoints of the interval, all these points, all these which we found, we calculate the values of f. We identify the maximum and minimum value of f out of the value which is computed here. This maximum value will be the absolute maximum value of f, and the minimum value will be the absolute minimum value of f. So, this is all about this chapter. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.